Welcome to another presentation about the origin of the Carolina Bays. This presentation discusses one of the major problems faced by the Glacier Ice Impact Hypothesis, which proposes that the Carolina Bays were created by secondary impacts of glacier ice ejected by an extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide ice sheet approximately 12,900 years ago. A paper with 71 authors published by Dalton in 2020 provides an updated radiocarbon-based ice margin chronology for the last deglaciation of the North American ice sheet complex. The paper by Dalton provides images of the ice coverage at various times during the Ice Age. This image shows that approximately 12,800 years ago, there was no ice on Lake Michigan. The Michigan Peninsula was ice-free. This lack of ice coverage has been used as an argument that the Carolina Bays could not have originated from secondary impacts of ice boulders ejected by an impact on the Laurentide ice sheet 12,900 years ago because there was no ice that could have been ejected. And in addition, there is no crater as evidence of an extraterrestrial impact. The Glacier Ice Impact Hypothesis proposes that the Carolina Bays are impact structures because they have a mathematically precise elliptical geometry that can be confirmed by fitting them with ellipses using the least squares method. Since ellipses are conic sections, it is likely that the bays originated as inclined conical cavities or penetration funnels, as can be demonstrated by impact experiments of ice projectiles on a viscous target. Usually, no objections are raised about the elliptical geometry of the Carolina Bays because well-preserved bays can be fitted with ellipses, but sometimes I get comments like, elliptical basins don't require impacts by ice. There are a few in Minnesota, including one at 48.922-95.847. I investigate these comments to see what I have overlooked. Compared to the Carolina Bays, this supposedly elliptical structure looks like a lake that has been shrinking and has developed multiple shorelines, but it does not have well-defined margins that can be used to select points for fitting an ellipse. The extraterrestrial impact is thought to have occurred during the Onaway Advance at 11,800 years before the present, abbreviated BP. This is a non-calibrated radiocarbon date. I asked Gemini, the Google Artificial Intelligence Assistant, to convert the radiocarbon date 11,800 BP to the number of calendar years ago. The response was, converting a radiocarbon date of 11,800 BP to calendar years ago requires considering the calibration curve, which accounts for variations in atmospheric radiocarbon levels over time. Using the INTCAL 20 calibration curve, a radiocarbon date of 11,800 BP corresponds to approximately 14,300 to 13,000 calendar years ago. This range reflects the uncertainty inherent in radiocarbon dating due to fluctuations in atmospheric radiocarbon concentrations. It is important to consult a specialized radiocarbon calibration database or software for the most accurate conversion, as the calibration curve is continuously refined with new data. There are several programs that reference the calibration curves to convert radiocarbon dates to calendar dates. The date range provided by Gemini was similar to the one published by Wickert in 2023, but the dates from Wickert are probably based on more current values. Wickert's image shows that approximately 12,900 years ago, half of Lake Michigan was covered with ice, the lower Michigan Peninsula was ice-free, and half of Lake Huron still was covered with ice. Correlating radiocarbon dates with calendar dates is complicated. The Oxford Radiocarbon Accelerator Unit, or RAU, is a radiocarbon laboratory that works across many disciplines including archaeology, biological and genetic research, earth science, and environmental science. The laboratory provides a radiocarbon dating service for people undertaking research in all these areas. The website explains why radiocarbon measurements are not true calendar ages. Radiocarbon measurements are always reported in terms of years before present, BP. This figure is directly based on the proportion of radiocarbon found in the sample. It is calculated on the assumption that the atmospheric radiocarbon concentration has always been the same as it was in 1950, and that the half-life of radiocarbon is 5,568 years. For this purpose, present refers to 1950, so you do not have to know the year in which the measurement was made. This plot shows how the radiocarbon measurement 3000 plus or minus 30 BP would be calibrated. The vertical axis shows radiocarbon concentration expressed in years before the present. The horizontal axis shows calendar years derived from tree ring data. The pair of blue curves show the radiocarbon measurements on the tree rings plus or minus one standard deviation. The red curve on the left indicates the radiocarbon concentration in the sample. The gray histogram in the bottom shows possible ages for the sample. The higher the histogram, the more likely the age is. The results of the calibration are often given as an age range. In this case, we could be 95% sure that the sample comes from between 1375 BC and 1129 BC in our current calendar. The Carolina Bays are the most prevalent geological structures in the Atlantic coastal plain. This LiDAR image shows hundreds of basins whose geometry can be verified to be elliptical by fitting them with ellipses using the least squares method. This is definitely not thermokarst, and aeolian lacustrine mechanisms are not known for creating mathematically elliptical structures with raised rims that sometimes overlap while maintaining their geometry. As far back as 1933, the origin of the Carolina Bays from impacts has been considered the most reasonable explanation, but at that time, the Nebraska Basins had not been discovered, so the bays had been attributed to impacts by meteorites. The discovery of the Nebraska Basins made it possible to triangulate a convergence point by the Great Lakes. Ballistic flights from that location would have required approximately 8 minutes. The Earth rotates eastward 0.25 degrees of arc for every minute of flight time. To compensate for the rotation of the Earth at the latitude of the convergence point, the location from where the projectiles were launched needs to be adjusted eastward by about 20 kilometers per minute of flight time. The dashed line indicates that a flight time of 8 minutes would have placed the point of origin of the projectiles that made the basins in the middle of Lake Michigan. According to Wickert 2023, this portion of Lake Michigan was covered with ice as late as 12,900 years ago. The impact of a comet fragment at this time and at this location would have ejected pieces of glacier ice in ballistic trajectories that could have formed the Nebraska Basins and the Carolina Bays. The energetic secondary impacts would also have triggered an extinction event in the ballistic sedimentation zone. The coverage of the ice sheet was changing very fast at the end of the Ice Age. According to Wickert, half of Lake Michigan was covered with ice 12,900 years ago, and according to Dalton, Lake Michigan had no ice 12,800 years ago. If these dates are accurate, the image by Dalton represents the ice coverage 100 years after the extraterrestrial impact that caused the formation of the Carolina Bays. There is additional evidence of ice coverage. A paper by Leyde et al. Says that the main channel to the eastern Great Lakes and North Atlantic opened at 13.0 to 12.7 kA. This channel opening was concurrent with the decreased runoff to the Gulf of Mexico and increased runoff through the lower Great Lakes to the Gulf of St. Lawrence and North Atlantic. It is important to note that if the flow through the St. Lawrence River opened only at 13.0 plus or minus 0.1 kA, this means that 12,900 years ago, at the time of the proposed extraterrestrial impact, there was still enough ice in the Michigan Peninsula to block the eastward flow of water. This also suggests that the extraterrestrial impact could have been responsible for breaking up the ice and starting the flow of water through the St. Lawrence River. The date 12,900 years ago is important because there are multiple indications of the global catastrophe at this time. In 2013, Petaev and three co-authors found a large platinum anomaly in the Greenland ice core that points to a cataclysm at the onset of the Younger Dryas. The Younger Dryas was a sudden cooling period that lasted about 1,200 years. Further work has shown that the platinum anomaly is widespread and can be used as a chronological marker in stratigraphic sequences. The Younger Dryas boundary, 12,900 years ago, also marks the extinction of the North American megafauna. Many animal species and the Clovis culture disappeared at this time. The energy of the ballistic sedimentation that formed the Carolina Bays was equivalent to about 8 megatons per square kilometer in some areas. A black mat marks the boundary of this extinction event. The Carolina Bays are fragile sandy structures. The rapid rate at which these land features are eroding implies that the Carolina Bays must have formed relatively recently in geological time. They may be 13,000 years old, but they cannot be much older than that. The smaller bay in this image has almost disappeared in 82 years. These Carolina Bays may be completely gone 10,000 years from now. There are other clues that the Carolina Bays originated from impacts about 12,900 years ago. One of the characteristics of impact cratering is inverted stratigraphy in the rim of a crater. The base material at the time of the impact is overlaid by the older material excavated by the impact, and then the older material is covered by younger material. A core sequence reported by Bunch in 2012 shows exactly these characteristics. The ice at the site of an extraterrestrial impact would have been ejected, and there would not have been any ice left at that location to melt and deposit the glacial debris and moraines that are used to determine the extent of ice coverage. An experiment by Professor Schultz shows that most of the ice at an impact site would have been blown away by the force of the impact. The secondary impacts of the ejected ice could presumably create secondary craters. Professor Schultz points out that an ice sheet acts as a shield that prevents the formation of a typical crater, and that wind and water erosion could soon erase all signs of the impact. The Nebraska basins have the same elliptical geometry as the Carolina Basin. Sometimes I get comments saying that there is Peoria, Loess in the Nebraska basins, and since the Loess is on top of the basins, these basins must have formed before they were covered by the Loess. Loess is a loosely compacted yellowish-gray deposit of windblown sediment. The Peoria Loess deposition occurred between about 27,000 and 17,000 years ago, and it covered parts of Nebraska and Iowa. A 1994 paper by Kusila says a subsurface investigation was conducted to determine the morphology of two basins in Clay County, Nebraska. Transects were located across two sample areas, and 17 test holes were drilled to determine Loess thickness and stratigraphy. Radiocarbon dates were obtained from buried paleosols. The modern basin landscape was determined to be the direct result of 2.5 to 8 meters of Loess deposition on an older basin landscape. The Peoria Loess is typically an aeolian, chalky, massive, light yellowish tan to buff silt that lies beneath the modern soil and typically overlies the Gilman Canyon formation. From the geological law of superposition, the Peoria Loess must be younger than the Gilman Canyon formation, but this also implies that the Nebraska basins must have existed before they were covered by the Peoria Loess. However, if the Nebraska basins originated from oblique impacts of ice boulders as proposed by the Glacier Ice Impact Hypothesis, the conical shockwave of the projectile would have displaced material laterally to open up the cavity, and viscous relaxation would have restored the stratigraphy. The Peoria Loess is within 5 meters of the surface, but the impact would have penetrated several hundred meters. The fact that a layer of Loess covers the Nebraska basins does not mean that the basins were created before the Loess was deposited. Impacts on unconsolidated soil displace material laterally to form a cavity, and the stratigraphy is restored by viscous relaxation, as demonstrated in this experiment in which an ice projectile penetrated a red layer in the target, and the stratigraphy was restored when the depth of the cavity was reduced by centripetal flow from the bottom up. The Glacier Ice Impact Hypothesis is controversial because there is no crater to prove that there was an extraterrestrial impact, and the source of the ice boulders that made the Carolina Bays is unknown. One thing is very certain. Well-preserved Carolina Bays and Nebraska Basins have a mathematically elliptical geometry that can be verified by the least squares method. These elliptical basins could not have been created by thermokarst or wind and water mechanisms. The ice that was at ground zero of the extraterrestrial impact in Michigan probably will never be found because it was blasted away to make the penetration funnels that form the Carolina Bays and Nebraska Basins. Someday we may find some material from Michigan at the apex of a Carolina Bay that will settle the question. Thank you for joining me in the investigation of the Carolina Bays and the Younger Dryas Cataclysm. The Carolina Bays should not be neglected. Ask your geology professors to discuss the Carolina Bays because they are the most prevalent geological structures in the Atlantic coastal plain. There's a link to the LiDAR visualization tool in the description of the video. My book about the Carolina Bays is available at Amazon. Subscribe to my YouTube channel to be notified of future videos about the Carolina Bays and other scientific topics.